Live from the Cactus Creek at Ibri, he is the king of prime time, Ghana's undisputed entertainment laureate, and still the youngest old man in Ghana. Put your hands together, show some love for the indefatigable KSM.
The KSM Show.
Folks, hold on. You have no idea how excited I am, man, because I'm meeting somebody that not only the whole world respects. But in the meantime, I want to show you a picture of him. He was much younger, he was a dazzling gentleman, and he is in this picture with his dazzling wife. Take a look at this.
KSM Show.
First of all, I'd like to welcome Hollard Life Insurance, who are now proudly associated with the KSM Show. Show Hollard Life Insurance some love, man. Now, I'm going to be telling you a whole lot about Hollard Life Insurance, but I want to start with an amazing product that they have. It's called Mibambo, which basically means my protection. Now, the amazing thing about this life insurance policy is this. It is very affordable. And all you need to have is a Vodafone SIM card. And you dial *269#, and follow the voice prompts. And you can pay as low as 1 cedi a month, or 5, or 15, or 30. You decide. And if anything should happen, a funeral or some major disability, they come and support you with 30,000 Ghana cedis, man. Now, I want you to listen to my favorite friend, Akrobeto.
Ah! It's what you did. A bush a piece of being 2,000 Ghana city near Fanshe, or Penny could be a yen. Ayaka!
Mommy, I have 2 boys in my home. See, my leg is broken. The hospital bill, they are finished. My house money, all they are disconnected. So, what for no money? You come and say it down, mommy.
And your family?
My Bambo Life Insurance and Tip and Mosome. A clear team, a dear chair here, a dear chance for my body. Who could first cover him? We catch a book and bunk. With little money like 1 cedi, who when you are from here, or catch him say, insurance dear, and your big man talk.
You just dial *269#. No about hash. Where we are?
Always is a chicken. It's a chicken.
With 1 Ghana cedi, 5 Ghana cedis, 15 Ghana cedis, or 30 Ghana cedis per month, you can get up to 30,000 Ghana cedis for funeral and disability cost. Dial *269# to sign up via Vodafone Cash today. Mibambo, insurance made for you.
Located in the calm green hills of Ibri is Ghana's best
reservation. We have some new numbers, and the new numbers are 0302-955-432 or 0302-965-460.
The best decision you'll ever make. Welcome home.
Pulse Fitness Center, the premier destination for fitness in Ghana. Meet the indefatigable captain.
There are 3 things that I love doing. Number 1, workout. Number 2, workout. Number 3, workout.
Workout put mind, soul, and body together.
The captain has spoken.
We're getting busy. Bright lights, yeah, they make me dizzy. Logo Liggy. I just want the Lizzie. It's a Logo Liggy. Uptown chasing for the Lizzie. Downtown, everybody busy. Logo Liggy. Life be Logo Liggy. I just want the paper.
Pulse Fitness Center. Yeah. East Legon Branch, Lizzie Sports Complex, Cotton Street, East Legon, Accra, Ghana. 0302-519-675. Kumasi Branches, Officers Mess Branch, Denyame, Major Kobina Drive, Kumasi. 0541-871-602. Golden Tulip Kumasi City Branch, Rain Tree Street. 0322-492-647. Pulse, the premier destination for fitness in Ghana. Say what lie we for on
town. Most of you are loving my jacket, Mr. Sao. I am if a rough. The jacket is provided by Asipa Essentials. So if you want some, this is the number to call, 0209-059-215. So call Asipa and get yourself a pretty decent jacket.
The KSM Show.
Fun out there. You see, she doesn't miss my show. And I'm sure she's watching. So the name is Tracy Forson. Big up to you, man. So Tracy, if you're watching, I'm also expecting you to be at Cactus Creek soon. Well, folks, I don't know how many of you were able to guess. But if you guess that, it is our former president, President J.A. Kufour. You guessed right. Senior. It's such a pleasure to be in your beautiful place. And I'm glad for this opportunity to
You talk know
to
you. You are always welcome here.
Thank
it's
you.
Your home.
Thank you, thank
so
you.
I'm happy to welcome you.
Fantastic, fantastic. Senior, can I call you senior, or should I say His Excellency?
Am I not senior?
you're my senior senior.
Right. If I say we were in Nigeria, and I was going to say if I were a Nigerian, if we were in Nigeria, you'd say senior president. So for all the titles you strengthen, but we are in Ghana, so senior should do.
I'll say senior His Excellency. At least I use the two.
You don't say senior His Excellency. If we are talking directly, then it's senior Your Excellency.
Oh, Your Excellency.
Your, because direct.
Thank you for the education.
Yes.
Senior but, Your Excellency.
Well.
Once again.
I would accept that. Welcome.
Fantastic, fantastic.
You're welcome.
We want to talk about so many things, I don't know where to start, but I'll just start with something that is quite current, because we've seen you a lot these days, and sometimes you're in a motorized wheelchair, and then earlier on we heard you had a back problem.
Yes.
But this is it, mostly when people get to your stature and they have any ailment, they fly abroad. You know, but I know that we had a back problem. Was it a back problem? But you decided to do your treatment right here in Ghana. Tell me a little bit about that.
Well, I decided not because of nationalism or whatever. I decided because I knew we had the competent professional doctors here. The professionals. So I didn't know why I would go anywhere else, say to Europe, Britain, or Switzerland, or to America. The lead doctor who operated had attained, you talked of stature. He was a top notch expert back in New York. He has a very popular clinic and was renowned for operating on patients from all over the world. People from Middle East, from Europe, America itself. And he happened to be a Ghanaian.
Yeah.
So, and that time too, he'd come to set up his clinic here, Focus. So when I felt the pain and went to see him, he put me through the MRI and then convinced me that he'd spotted where the trouble was and that the only way out or forward was an operation. I think it was some twisted bone that needed.
Was it in the back?
Lower back.
Oh, lower back.
So once we agreed on that.
He went ahead.
And he assembled a team of about 10 doctors, all top-notch professionals.
Ghanaians?
Ghanaians, all of them. First, he was going to operate in his theater at Focus. But then critical moment, he decided against that, said, because the other doctors coming were, I think all of them were based in Kolebu, and they were used to the equipment in the Kolebu theater. He thought asking them to come and assist in his new place where the equipment perhaps were new, and they might not be used to his equipment. He thought he rather.
So the actual surgery was done in Kolebu?
The surgery was done in Kolebu.
Folks, it was all you, but we don't. Wow. That's brilliant. That's brilliant.
And after the operation, they kept me overnight when I came back to out of the whatever operation. They stabilized me there, and then the next day they moved me to.
Back to focus.
Back to
focus. How long were you in focus once they moved
About you? About a fortnight.
Oh, wow. Wow. But here you are, you know, nice, tall, gentle giant, as we used to call you, you know. And now you have to use your motorized wheelchair. And when the walking became a problem, did that have any effect on you? Say, wow, you know, is this what age does? Or did that have any impact on you?
If you like, because of vanity, we tend to be vain. Yeah. Otherwise, at my age, and all the experiences I've been privileged to go through, if I now reduce to this, naturally I would be a bit sad, but I think I'm adjusted psychologically.
Okay.
I accept my situation.
So initially, it had an effect.
Initially,
then
it was a bit different, and I felt a bit embarrassed having to be helped like a toddler and that sort of thing. But I think currently.
But now you're okay with
I'm
it.
I'm okay with it.
Fantastic, fantastic. And let me quickly ask this, you know, President of Ghana, top, top, top position, you know.
Yes.
And you're there for 8 years. You're the ultimate, the most powerful man in Ghana. Immediately you leave office, I'm talking about the first 1, 2, 3 months, is there some trauma you go through? Do you have to remind yourself, I'm no longer in this position? Or naturally you just adjust to not being president?
Really, I didn't suffer a trauma like you are putting it. I was a bit saddened because I had expected to be succeeded by, I'm a party man.
Yeah,
by somebody from my party's candidate. Yeah. It didn't happen like that. And unfortunately for me, the change was occasioned by initially the incoming government, the new government, didn't treat me with the decorum I thought they should have given me. For instance, before I stepped out of office, an officer had been prepared for me near the State House, an old bungalow, and an outgoing president should be entitled to a bungalow from the state, which had been prepared for me to go into. Before I knew, some people had come with red bands around their head protesting, telling me to go back to my home, that's to Kumasi, where, like I was a stranger in Ghana, Accra. I didn't like that. But I, with all the noises and protests, I moved out of that.
So you didn't use the office?
I was there for a while and then moved out just to quieten the uncalled for noises. So that was it. But and then they also made it seem I had taken the presidential vehicles with me. I didn't need any vehicles from the. It was state, I think, protocol and security that had assigned some vehicles for me to use. But there was so much noise. He took away the state bulletproof car and so forth and so on. I didn't need that. So that too. But that aside, and because I didn't sort of go out protesting, the noises quietened down. And so, in any case, I lived in my own house throughout the entire presidency of 8 years. I lived in my own house. And so the noises quietened. And so that was it. But as for really waking up and not seeing myself as president and that causing me a trauma, No. I felt so fulfilled because I was, in the real sense, the first civilian president to have served the entire constitutional term to step down. First ever. We take it. Our first president, Osagyefo Kwame Nkrumah, was removed by soldiers. Yeah. My greatest mentor, Buzia, was removed by soldiers. Unfortunately, Dr. Liman, my friend, was removed by soldiers. And the fourth president, I always use the analogy of a leopard. He was essentially a soldier, Rawlings. And so when he converted himself from uniform to civis and stayed on for two terms and stepped down for me to come, yeah, he did well, but his military nature still stuck with him. Mm-hmm. So I really wouldn't accord him. And because
the first civilian,
president to have served full term since independence, me. Mm. So I felt I had done well by our constitution, and I felt very grateful, rather.
Mm-hmm. 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 Great. Let me pick on something from you mentioned. You know the way you were treated after office. Does it have something to do with this winner takes all mentality that we have in Ghana?
A bit of it. We are evolving, but we haven't come as yet come to the point where we will treat people who've been given the opportunity to serve, because it's service. When they finish, we must accord them the decencies and respects that should be given to. You do that for the office.
And the office, inspire, not the personality.
To inspire the up-and-coming people who would also want to serve their nation. So.
Yeah. No, I only brought that up because I know presidents have complained about their treatment right after office. And but why should that be, in your opinion? Well, so winner takes all, you have everything. But why don't you respect the office?
We've alluded to winner takes all. And also to the fact that since independence, we've tended, the First Republic, for instance, didn't end well because by the time it finished and it was through a coup d'etat, the rancor was too much, the bitterness, because the regime had become a one-party state. And with many of the opponents locked up in prison detention. And we say the late Dr. J.B. Dankwa, the chief opponent of the regime, dying in prison. So I think the bitterness was so deep. And so the change that came was visited with this, if you like, animosity from the opposition to the regime, the outgoing, that wasn't good. The same thing was repeated with Buzia. Was overthrown just after 2 years, 3 months, and with a hail of abuse and unjustified attacks and insults. I, for instance, was picked up. I was deputy minister under him. I stayed in Ashaford prison for 1 year, 3 months. So naturally, there would be some pent-up feeling. Then Dr. Liman, nice gentleman. I never heard a word of insult from him. But he was kicked out unceremoniously. And then New Year's Eve of all days. Can you imagine a coup d'etat taking place that time? And this poor man apparently depended on a pickup, former president of Ghana, his own pickup that was breaking down every now and then in streets of Accra. It wasn't right at all. But that was the treatment he got from the so-called revolutionary takeovers. And so that's it. And so it's, I think, I'm praying that this trend is dying out. So would accord any person, any Ghanaian that would legitimately work their way up to this pedestal, as you say. It's a one and only position. It's not something, there can't be two presidents at any given time. So once a Ghanaian out of a population of over 30 million gets there legitimately and we call him president, whether he succeeded in satisfying us or not, we should
respect the office.
Accord him the respects of the office.
I'm looking at a case where somebody has fought hard and has gotten there, and the person himself or herself is not according that office what is expected. What do you advise in the...
Well, if the person managed to get there and yet wouldn't appreciate the weight of the office to behave himself or herself as expected, there are ways. Look at the United States now. I'm sure you are following the trends there now of Mr. Trump. You know the investigations going on with the threats that he might even be charged. So there are ways to do it. And we should find the enlightened ways of treating people who sort of abuse the privileges accorded them by the state.
Well, it is absolutely getting fantastic. But then again, we have to take a short commercial break. There are plenty of questions I need to ask. When we come back from this break, I'm hanging out with President Kufour, my senior. And by the way, I'm calling him my senior because he went to Pampa College every day. Show some love for President. So after this commercial break, we'll be right back.
KSM Show.
First of all, I'd like to welcome Hollard Life Insurance, who are now proudly associated with the KSM Show. Show Hollard Life Insurance some love, man. Now, I'm going to be telling you a whole lot about Hollard Life Insurance, but I want to start with an amazing product that they have. It's called Mibambo, which basically means my protection. Now, the amazing thing about this life insurance policy is this. It is very affordable. And all you need to have is a Vodafone SIM card. And you dial *269#, and follow the voice prompts. And you can pay as low as 1 cedi a month, or 5, or 15, or 30. You decide. And if anything should happen, a funeral or some major disability, they come and support you with 30,000 Ghana cedis, man. Now, I want you to listen to my favorite friend, Akrobeto.
Ah! It's what he did. A bush of peace will be into 1,000 Ghana city near Fanshe, or Penny could be a yen. Ayaka!
Mommy, I have 2 boys in my home. See, my leg is broken. The hospital bill, they are finished. My house money, all they are disconnected. So, what for no money? You come and say it now, mommy.
And your family home.
Me bamboo life insurance in tip, and was summoning. A player, Timmy, a dear chair, a dear chance for my body, who could first cover him. Me catch the book and bunk. With little money like 1 cedi, when you are soon here, or catch him say, insurance, dear, in your big man talk.
You just dial *269#. No, but hash! Where we
always is a chicken, it's a chicken.
With 1 Ghana cedi, 5 Ghana cedis, 15 Ghana cedis, or 30 Ghana cedis per month, you can get up to 30,000 Ghana cedis for funeral and disability cost. Dial *269# to sign up via Vodafone Cash today.
Wait, I'm not ready.
Mibambo, insurance made for you.
Located in the calm green hills of Ibiri is Ghana's best.
To make your reservation, we have some new numbers. And the new numbers are 0302-955-432 or 0302-965-460.
The best decision you'll ever make. Welcome home.
There is nothing that beats on-time arrival and departure when you're flying. You want to tell your people, I am arriving at this time, and they want to be at the airport, and at that time, you are there. And if you want to do that, trust me, the name is Passionair. And the hotline to reach them is 0800-221-221. Folks, I always tell you that if you have putting a lot of mileage on your car, the wear and tear is protected the best by Havoline oil lubricants. So if you have a car that is really, actually, always at work, the name is Havoline. And by the way, I got a few calls from people who said they are interested in actually working as distributors for Havoline products. I checked with them and they have actually given me a number. So if you're interested in being a distributor for Havoline products, this is the number to call. 059-944-3300. And in case you want to service your car and change your engine oil with Havoline lubricants, then please, by all means, do it at A to Z Automobile Servicing. As you can see, folks, I have donned my Adipa Essentials. If you want any of these jackets or one like these, this is the number to call. 0209-059-215. So call Adipa and get yourself a pretty decent jacket.
KSM Show.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. And today we are coming to you from the residency of His Excellency President J. Kufour. That's where we are in Abri, and it's just a fantastic, comfortable place. Senior, are you enjoying your post-presidency? Just, you know, beautiful place.
Thank God I'm enjoying the situation.
Fantastic, fantastic. Let me rewind back, go to the times you were president. They say it is lonely at the top. Sometimes you have to take decisions that maybe majority of your cabinet doesn't agree with, but you think through it.
Yeah.
And I don't know how true it is, but I hear on declaring HIPIC was a situation like that for you, that not many got along with you on that position. Was it a lonely decision to make?
It was. It was right at the beginning of my tenure.
Yes.
2001, and we had, through the campaigning to become president, we promised a lot. We talked about going to usher in the golden age of business and the economy, what we'll do, and this and that and that. We got in there only to find very empty coffers, and not just empty coffers, but piles and piles of loans, indebtedness. The nation was practically insolvent. And a typical example was where the filling stations, petrol filling stations, were all full of long queues of vehicles. Why? Because
fuel shortages.
There's no petrol to sell, to supply them. And we found that Nigeria, the main supplier of our crude for refining at Temaoi Refinery, had blacklisted Ghana, refusing to sell to us. Why? Because we weren't paying.
Ghana was on the blacklist?
Ghana was not paying for the supplies, so they cut us off. And so we had to rush quickly to Nigeria to virtually beg the president of Nigeria and their president, Aso Rock.
When you say we had to rush, your
I had
or
to.
Or you, yourself?
Myself. It was a state thing. And I needed to get my government and economy working. So I went there to plead. And at the president's Aso Rock, as they call it, the president assembled his entire cabinet, team sitting in his presidential seat.
And he asked you to address them?
And poor me, not asked me to address them. He asked for the mission of the visit. And I said, we come to plead for them to restore supplies to Ghana. The place was dead quiet. President threw the head back a bit, like, listen, when I finish my plea, he said, well, our policy is not to continue supplying people who do not pay. So this is why we are not supplying Ghana. And I pleaded that mine was a new government, and we needed to have a fair start. And with the assurance that when they supplied, my government would do everything to try to pay. Then President shot back, well, then you would have to give a written undertaking that when we supply, you pay. And something hit me. I sensed that the mood was softening a bit. So I said, all right, Mr. President, if that's the only thing you want, then please give me paper and pen so I write for you right here now. But when you supply me, I'll pay.
Mm-hmm.
So he burst out laughing, and the entire room also was resonant with noise. Everybody was happy. So that when the laughing died down, and the President Obasanjo came back, said, all right, then we'll give you 30,000 barrels of crude a day with 90-day supplies credit. You see the benefit. So if every day tomorrow will be given 30,000.
So you literally had to write down another ticking?
No, when I challenged him to give me the paper, I was prepared if he had. But that was not what he intended. He wanted a formal sort of agreement.
Okay, okay.
But I got him saying, all right, give me paper and then I'll write for you here that when you supply me. He laughed himself out and then he said, all right, we give you 30,000 barrels of crude a day. And then 90-day supplies credit, that will give you credit, so you refine and pay us within 90 days. That's what did the trick. And true to his word, from that time, through the eight-year period of my government, the supplies came.
Kept constant.
Coming. So that was a typical example of, so it was very rough, and you talked of APEC. Creditors were not looking at us at all. We were not getting benefit, and the macroeconomy was right out. In fact, in shambles, if I may use the word. And there was a conference in Bamako, in Mali. Now, within the first month or two of my government, that I had been invited to, and I went with a small team. There at the conference, it was an international conference. I found that the managing director of IMF was attending. The president of the World Bank was there. The British minister of international development, whatever authority was there, a lady, Claire Schultz. So during the conference, during a break at the conference, these three people somehow cornered me, just conversing. And I sensed straight away that they were sizing me up because I was a new boy on the block. The World Bank president was Wolfensohn, Mr. Wolfensohn. The IMF managing director was Mr. Horst Koller, German, Horst Koller. Very nice, soft-spoken man. And the lady minister from Britain was Claire Schultz. They were asking about the policies with which I had come to power, what we intended to do, and the economy, the difficulties. Well, I was trying to tell them my government was private sector friendly, we were democratic, and so forth and so on. They didn't show much about their feelings. They didn't talk back and how they knew our situation. It took the lady, after I had rambled on a bit, to shoot back and say, look, everybody knows the state of your economy in Ghana. If you tell the truth about your economy, then you may get the help you need. But if you won't tell, then perhaps people may not also rally to you. So I looked at her a bit and I shot back. And I said, suppose I tell the truth about my economy and I do not get the help I want, what would become of me? They laughed a bit. And then she assured me, look, if you tell the truth about your economy and we all know the difficulties, then I give you my word, my government would come to your assistance. So is that the case? And what's the truth that I should tell? You're a hypocrite. You're a highly indebted poor country. So if you would avail yourself of the IMF arrangements and work with IMF, then you may get the reliefs you want. Sinest. Because that year, 2001, we needed something like a quarter of $1 billion just to service the loans we owed. Service, so not to pay for the principal, interest payments.
The interest.
And we didn't have the money. And because we were not paying interest and loans, nobody was looking at us. I've told you of the Nigerian situation. So that registered with me. The one thing that the managing director of the IMF said then, and he too kept his word, was that, and if you take the step, I give you my word, that's I'm trying to quote him or paraphrase him, I give you my word, we'll work with you so you get out of the bind in record time. Let's do the completion point of APEC.
So basically they're waiting for an admission from you this is the state we are in?
That's what, because the previous regime had put the country there, but pride didn't make it to admit that we'd come to a cross where we couldn't even service our debts, let alone pay principals. And because of that, you know the state of the economy we inherited. Inflation was over 40%, I think 42%. Inflation, if you wanted to borrow from the banks commercially, interest was as high as 50-something percent. What business could any businessman do with having to pay an interest like that? The currency, the cedi against the dollar, and we trade with the dollar. You want $1 US dollar, you needed a cocoa sack of cedis, whole sack full of cedis to go into the forex to change to get the dollar. So it was impossible for us to really make a move with all the plans we'd come to office with. In fact, to the extent that one of the ministers that had, in the previous regime, had boastfully spoken publicly that whether government would last for even 3 months, they were waiting to see. I don't want to mention his name, but perhaps you may know this official. It had come out publicly. So it was a huge challenge. But then I've talked of vanity, the pride in us was preventing us to own up that the economy was in a very messy state. And so these three people wanted me to consider admitting that the situation was messy and that we needed help. And so I came back to Ghana and of course assembled my government. Said, look, nobody wants to hear the word HIPIC. So let's think out, what's the alternative to HIPIC we could use so we can break loose and begin to govern? And we assembled some of the sharpest economic brains. HIPIC, no. Too humiliating, we can't think this and that, but nothing clicked. So it got to the point where I felt forced to put an ultimatum to cabinet. Look, if you are not giving me alternative to HIPIC, then I take the responsibility
and declare
to declare HIPIC. Minister of Finance, go to Parliament, tell Parliament, President has decided.
Going HIPIC.
And he did that. There was a bit of grumbling and uproar, but because there wasn't any alternative, really practical alternative, people kept quiet. And true to her word, the minister from Britain was first to have forgiven the £50 million we needed to service our indebtedness to that country that year. And because she took that step, other creditors followed suit. And the first year, we were allowed to go free from having to find money to pay the quarter of $1 billion just to pay interest.
Do you like feel vindicated? Say, I knew it. Was there a sense of like victory for you that almost like a personal?
I was very happy naturally, but I wasn't sort of flaunting it boastfully that we done it or we knew it. Or I felt thankful, privileged that one for attending that conference. I could have said no. I could have sent somebody to represent, but I went. And I was very happy meeting the three people. For instance, I hadn't met Claire Short ever before, the minister from Britain. That was the first time. Mr. Hoyt-Scholar, I don't think I had met before, the IMF managing director, but he proved to be such a humane, sensitive person, caring person. And then Wolfensohn, the World Bank president, I think I had met him faintly before, but that the three of them got together and we got into this conversation that led to their assuring me of their ready support. I felt thankful for. And then when the cancellation of payments came, so we decided whatever little thing we could do anywhere, we printed on the walls, benefit of HIPIC. So, people mocked us for that.
I did. I was one of them.
Oh, you were one of them. And so you've come to trick me to talk.
I was one of them. No credit, yeah.
Yes. But that really did the trick for us. And it started opening the gates. And I was fortunate. Again, a Ghanaian who had worked with the IMF for a long time, for decades, was about to retire. I didn't know him before. I don't remember ever meeting him before. But some IMF official, I think he's Iranian from Iran. The name is Abbas Miracle. And he'd been like the country director for Ghana and some other countries in West Africa. Was visiting. And already our country had been fined, F-I-N-E-D, fined. For misreporting, right? When you sort of you don't tell the whole truth to IMF, and they fine you. And Ghana had been fined, I think, to the tune of $36 million for misreporting to that organization. And we were at our wit's end. I didn't know what to do. The then governor, again, talking of our seniors, he was a senior, and I felt he was like my young brother. You know, was my youngest brother's classmate. When I was from five, they were from one.
Okay.
Smart guy, intelligent and all. But he happened to be the governor under the previous regime. And it was during those times the misreporting had occurred. But it was my government that was being penalized to find it. And we needed to find adjustment with the central bank. So this guy from Iran came, visiting Ghana, called on me, and during the conversation, he raised the point again. Look, what are you doing with your central bank? I said, what? We're trying to see how best we can work with it to restore the macroeconomy. Guy said, oh, look, there's a Ghanaian working with IMF, about to retire. And Mr. President, if you could get him to become your governor of the central bank, I tell you, your efforts would yield very positively, because he's good. He knows the system and would exact the disciplines needed for you to do meet the conditionalities quickly, get out of them quickly. So I said, who is this Ghanaian? Mentioned the name, it turned out to be Dr. Paul Akwa. So I said, well, when you get back, let him come and see me. So Paul Akwa turned up, quiet in his own way, but there was an aura of solidity about him, efficiency and all that. Well, so we did the necessary shifting, and Paul Akwa became the governor. And I tell you, this guy lived up to the expectation. Practically every week he would come with some file under his armpit here, sit with me, and was like an examiner of how my government worked the fiscal and monetary policies, and didn't spare, told me the truth about the performance of government. And things worked out so well. And then the cooperation we got from IMF under Hoist Scholar progressed beautifully. And as I told you earlier, Mr. Hoist Scholar had promised that he would use his good offices to help Ghana to work her way out of the challenges in record time. But before the 2 years or so that we expected to use to finish were up, report came that Germany had virtually drafted Hoist Scholar to go and become president of Germany, the Republic of Germany. So I felt like, so if this man is leaving IMF, how would I finish this thing in record time? He went, but the goodwill remained, and Paul Akwa worked with the government, my government, so well that we still managed to finish the completion point, as they call it, in record time. And with that, much of the indebtedness got written off by, I believe, the multilateral creditors, and even some bilateral creditors, running into over 4 billion United States dollars.
It's all
written off. So that was significant. And with that, now getting out of the confidence the international community had in the regime rose so high and so fast. Everything seemed to be coming together so well for Ghana. That's where the recovery came.
Show some love, man. Sadly, for this episode, a time or so, but I say for this episode because I have to stay another, 40 minutes and try and finish off this conversation with Senior. So for those of you watching, stick around, because next week we're going to be coming back with the conclusion. Until next week, Senior, yeah, we are signing off here, but we are not leaving. We want to come and finish it small. Yeah. So folks, until next week when we come back,
You want to squeeze me.
Small.
Try me with all the details you can squeeze out of me. I'm going to make you pay for that.
So stick around, folks. Next week, I'm going to pay for the squeezing, but I'll squeeze more. So stick around until next week when we come back. Reporting from, this is not Asuroko. This is what? This is. How do you call here?
If the government would allow me, I may call this place Pedriasi Annex.
So sending off from the Pedriasi Annex, let me say, until next week when we're back at the Pedriasi Annex.
When you talk lodge, you are talking of the president's lodge.
I know the lodge is here.
I don't
this
want
the
any trouble. I don't want any
So folks, until next week, we are out of here.